English pop singer Paul Carrick said after I was in a pop group called Ace doing a pop song called How Long Has This Been Going On, instead of Eric Stewart, I would have sung the lead on The Things We Do for Love, done by 10cc from their 1977 album called Deceptive Bends, before I formed a pop group called Squeeze to do a song called Tempted by the Fruit of Another, taken from their 1981 album, East Side Story. Paul Carrick thought he wanted to record his own lead vocal on The Things We Do for Love, done by 10cc, but instead, Eric Stewart wanted to do it because his dream was to sound like Paul Carrick on the original recording of this tune. So he turned his dream into reality. And the only thing is, Paul and Eric would have been close friends with each other. My biggest complaint about the Gizmotron that Kevin and Lol invented years ago made the music strange and unreal. I just don't like how it sounds. No, I don't. I just prefer real music without the Gizmotron. Since I don't like strange music, I am not a big fan of the Gizmotron. As far as I know, Godley and Cream hated the song, The Things We Do for Love, that Eric Stewart and Graham Gouldman were working on. So Kevin and Lol had to move on by working on their first album, Consequences.
But to us then, me and Kev had been spent the previous 4 or 5 months grinding out this side one of Consequences, and the nature of the music that we were making was so far removed from the 10cc music, and we became consumed with it, and Things We Do for Love just seemed like another I'm Not in Love type of thing, which is all very well, but we didn't want to do that.
And they said that they didn't want to continue to do it anymore. They wanted to pursue their own careers, I guess, and try and do something with the Gizmo. Part of me had tremendous admiration for them for doing it, and another part of me just thought they were completely mad.
I was trying desperately to keep them together. I really was. And even with hindsight, probably they would have been better off being kept together. But in those days, bands had to deliver on a budget, on a time scale. So although like 20 years later, it would be nothing for a member of any band to say, look, I'm taking a year off, I'm going to do my own album, and I'm coming back later. And it's sad, because together they were a power.
I think at the end of the day, there's a natural lifespan of a band. It's a bit like the Spinal Tap film. You know, something else is going to happen within the band that will trip you up a bit. And initially, you can take it and say, all right, let's just carry on with it. But in the back of your mind, you're thinking, what's going on? Why is this not working the way it did?
If I had my time over again, I suppose, within the band, I probably did too much talking and not enough strangling, which would probably clear the air quicker. But, you know, you have other ambitions that don't necessarily have to be realised within that particular situation. And we kind of wanted to take 6 months off and do this experiment. But because we were forced into a corner and forced to leave because of it, we turned it into this gigantic Heaven's Gate style project. But that wouldn't have happened if we'd have been given the room to maneuver. So in a sense, it was a shame.
I regret the upset that it caused, hugely. because it was like a divorce, you know. It was like a big divorce. It was caused terrible eruptions, you know, socially and all the rest of it, because my wife Ange and Gloria, Eric's wife, are sisters. So it caused a terrible kind of rift in the family. But we couldn't stop ourselves from moving on.
It was a real shame, and something I'm still upset about to this day, because I think we could have done major things. Even though Eric and I carried on and did very well, it was different. It was different.
I never knew from the start that Kevin Godley and his friend Laurie and Lol Creme were art students, because in the beginning they studied art when they were young. On YouTube, when I saw the original video of The Things We Do for Love, I noticed that there were music video problems destroying the beauty done in a British style, and I never appreciate how it was made years ago, since 1977. So I changed it to the Shane and Kimberly version of that song, which is my absolute favorite, that I am always impressed with, rather than the original music video version that was a mess from many moons ago. Speaking of The Things We Do for Love, which is my absolute favorite, instead of the bland, unmodified original without the gospel elements, you would have sung the modified remake done by Karen West with more gospel elements in the background, like this.
Like walking in the rain and snow when there's nowhere to go, when you're feeling like a part of you is dying, and you're looking for the answer in her eyes. You think you're gonna break up, then she says she wants to make up. You made me love you.
See, that's much better, with gospel background vocals sounding like the Andre Crouch choir, the Andre Crouch singers, the Mighty Clouds of Joy, Supreme Jubilees, the New York Community Choir, the Drinkard Singers, the Jim Gilstrap singers, the Sissy Houston singers, the Staples singers that sang my favorite gospel soul tune, I'll Take You There, the Edwin Hawkins singers that sang Oh Happy Day and Jesus Lover of My Soul, brothers and sisters, the voices of East Harlem, the New Freedom Singers, Ted Wortham and Company, who backed up Mac and Katie Kassoon on And the Lord Said, and Pop Blue-Eyed Soul husband and wife duo Cindy and Roy. On the flip side of Can You Feel It, While We Still Have Time, written by Ted Wortham and his friend Cynthia Biggs, taken from their only one album released on the Casablanca Record and Filmworks label in 1979, entitled Feel It. While they sang their own song, I'm Going on a Journey, plus Precious Memories, and the flip side, Take the Lord Everywhere. Mighty Voices of Wonder, or The Horace Family, rather than 10cc's original with Lazy, Sleepy Time, Beach Boys Sound Alike background vocal harmonies that never sounded like Somebody Have Mercy by the late soul singer Sam Cooke.
Somebody have mercy and tell me what is wrong with me.
On 10cc's original recording of The Things We Do for Love, when I heard Eric and Graham provide the tired and sleepy Beach Boys sound alike background vocals, they sounded like tired and lazy, shy and powerless, weak and dreary, weary and mundane singing people instead of gospel singing people in the manner of the Spear family. Now let's hear what Eric Stewart and Graham Gouldman have to say about themselves for their post-split 1977 debut album entitled Deceptive Bends with their associate and loyal friend Paul Burgess.
I think the idea was that we'd go in the studio, there was just myself, Eric and Paul Burgess on the drums, and we'd just go in with the same attitude and just write some songs, see what happens.
Without Kevin Lowell there, I suddenly felt it was easier, a lot easier. And I worked so hard on that album. Obviously, I had something to prove, mainly to myself, that I could do it. But it had The Things We Do for Love, and that was such a massive hit. It sold more in the States than I'm Not in Love. So we were pleased, very, very pleased.
You lay your bets and then you pay the price. The things we do for love.
The things we do for love.
Like walking in the rain and the snow when there's nowhere to go. When you're feeling like a part of you is dying.
I'm very proud of the album. I think the album's great. I think we came up with some really interesting stuff. I can sense slightly we're trying to be Kevin Lowell at some point, but even so, I thought it was very good, and it was quite a well-received album. Things We Do For Love became a massive hit in America, and Good Morning Judge was a hit as well.
When I was listening to Eric Stewart sing the lead on The Things We Do For Love, done by British pop band 10cc, his lead singing voice reminded me of Paul Carrick. And after all these years, I still love that song.